Do you also feel like video games today are way too bloated, taking up more space than they should realistically need? I mean, you probably do, considering this meme gets reposted like clockwork every once in a while on all social media platforms and goes viral without exception, so there must be truth to it, right? Of course, like all great thinkers, this is an issue I always have on the back burner, ready to be addressed. At some point, but never just right now. You know, well, one day I was scrolling through Reddit and came across a really interesting concept. A JavaScript program that displays a clock in real time using just the code of the program itself. A Quine, in essence. Just a bit more elaborate than its base concept. Really cool, I thought to myself as I was about to scroll by, because my degraded brain was approaching the limits of its attention span and was ready to move on to looking for the next dopamine hit. But then it hit me. This is actually a prime opportunity to make myself suffer some more while trying to solve a problem nobody really cares about, in a way that's gonna infuriate anybody involved. It's a proverbial golden goose for masochists. I mean, the line of thinking is pretty logical, although there might be a small fallacy considering the one that decided my argument is logical is also me, but let's brush past that. Look, the bulk of a modern game's size is never the code itself. Quite the opposite. On the other hand, stuff like assets, audio, external software like anti-cheats, redistributables, libraries, all dwarf the size of the code itself and ultimately bloat the final size. And for what, I ask? More detailed pores and wrinkles on the characters' faces? Eargasm quality audio and epic scores that would make even Mozart salivate? Accessibility? Multiple languages? In my game? All absolutely useless, I tell you. My goal is to take games to their origins, stripping all the useless stuff and reaching that pure, concentrated gamer essence, all in a properly self-contained package. And because simply making a game and calling it a day is way too boring, I thought, hey, people will definitely want to try making their own once this takes off, so why don't I create a whole suite of tools to help create and transform basic game programming into actual Quine games? A very reasonable train of thought, dare I say, which, and you don't have to thank me for it, led me to creating a Quine Game Engine, which allows you to develop games as you would do it normally, except using APIs developed by yours truly, and compiling them using a custom tool that converts your beautiful creations into their most condensed form. Now, for the game I'd be implementing, I thought that I shouldn't do something too basic, like Snake or Pong, as one, there's a high chance someone already did those, as a Quine no less, and two, it wouldn't really test the limits of the tools I'm making, as you can go pretty compact by default with any games of that type. In the end, I chose Pac-Man. You know, that funny big bald fella from the Pixels movie? Oh, and from that obscure game from the 80s, I guess. You see, I knew that the game had a couple of rules and some interesting mechanics, but I never really deep dived into those kinds of details about it. So imagine my surprise when I came across entire articles describing each individual mechanic, and turns out they are rather complex, although may not seem at first glance. The core idea is that you have to collect all the points on the board while trying to escape four ghosts. Pretty simple, right? Well, first and foremost, those four ghosts are not just clones of each other. Sure, they have some common behavior. They cycle between chasing and scattering four times, ending with a permanent chase state. Additionally, if Pac-Man consumes an energizer or power pellet, they all become frightened, start running at random, and can be eaten, leading to them going back to the safe house. All of these states have a duration associated, but the differences arise from how each state manifests for each individual ghost, and from the point threshold at which they are released from the safe house. When scattering, each has a separate target cell located outside of the board that they try to reach, which leads to them running in a circle. As for chasing, let's begin with Blinky, who starts outside of the house and his first direction is left. Oh yeah, I should also mention that they are all a bit smart, as their moves are calculated a tick before they take place. Well, our buddy Blinky here is pretty straightforward. His target is exactly Pac-Man's position, earning his name of Chaser or Pursuer. Pinky, on the other hand, starts inside the safe house, but her threshold is zero, so she immediately leaves it. When chasing, she always looks at Pac-Man's position and orientation and sets her target at 4 tiles ahead of that, earning her Ambusher title. This also created a famous overflow error bar when Pac-Man was facing upwards, which is pretty cool if you wanna look into. Inky is released once the player gets 30 points, but but like with Clyde, it decreases as the levels progress. Well, Inky here is described as whimsical due to the fact that his movements are seemingly harder to predict. Similar to Pinky, it first calculates the position 2 tiles ahead of Pac-Man, and then draws a vector from Linky's position through the future position of Pac-Man and doubles its length. That is his target. Finally, Clyde, initially released once a score of 60 is reached, is described as feigning ignorance, being rather disingenuous. If he's more than 8 tiles away from Pac-Man, his target is identical to Blinky, meaning Pac-Man itself. Otherwise, his target is the same as in his scatter mode. Yeah, that's quite a good chunk of logic to be implemented there. And I haven't even talked about how Ichigo's speed changes across the game loop, or the special fruits, and even the levels themselves, as I realized the final code would be too big to even be properly displayed. So I kinda ditched some of them and simplified others, so that levels are no longer if conditionals, and rather based on a global level multiplier, dictating how fast the ghosts change states as well as their release thresholds and some other tweaks. Well, now with that high overview, you can imagine that there was a lot to pack into as small a package as possible. Thing is, I was writing the implementation as I was reading about its details, so I only got to look at the final line count when it was over, which let's say was a tiny bit more than I expected. Although in part it probably is due to the fact that I, for some reason, thought it would be fun to do the whole thing in C. So now, I find myself with an almost 1000-line C program that I somehow want to compress enough so that its code can be shown in its entirety on a normal display, with the added side note that to print its code you have to get its textual representation in a variable that will be printed as part of the code. So unless you have runtime access to it, your program size doubles by default. And as such, three options presented to me. The first one is to try and compress the existing C code by any means necessary. The second is so that by the will of the gods themselves, write a minifier for the C language. I should mention that the minifier removes all unnecessary characters from code without altering its functionality, so it needs to properly parse and understand the syntax and logical flows of the language it's applied upon. Or third and last, switch to a language that both has existing minifiers and some kind of runtime reflection, that is, JavaScript. Well, the first one is both rather hard to achieve and also invalidates the whole game engine shtick, so out the window it goes. The second is rather tempting, and it is true that sometimes I contemplate conceding all my mental faculties, but to ensure that the final solution is actually usable for more than my hyper-tuned case, the third option emerges as victor. Translating the code from one language to the other wasn't too big of a hurdle, especially considering the JS version was 40% smaller, but it did help me better highlight and isolate the different parts of the program and have a clear view over what I want the library to include. In contrast to the solution I came up with in the creating games using SQL video, where I didn't bother separating the logic from the rendering of frames, here I opted for updating the internal logic based on a fixed tick rate, which can be configured. This way, even if the frame rate varies, the logic will be updated consistently, accounting for both cases in which frames are rendered too slowly, as well as for when they exceed the expected value. Thus, it's only logical I move this logic to the lib source file, exposing the onframe render and onGame tick methods, which can be overridden, or better said, reassigned. These are called from the main run loop, which contains and handles both the tick rates as well as the application run state. I also expose the init, before run, and after run methods to be overridden, in case the developer wants to do something in any of those states. I also exposed methods that allow you to set the initial config, key bindings, the app's running state, the ID of the elements to which the script will attach itself, a onWindow resize callback, and most importantly, the setPixel method. As an artifact from the C implementation, where console IO is really slow on Windows, so as to prevent flickering, I had it so instead of re-rendering the entire frame every time, I simply keep count of the changes determined by the internal ticks, add them to a queue, then simply modify the exact positions that need changing. In this case, instead of moving the cursor using ANSI codes, I update the style of the DOM elements at the specified position. This is achieved easily because, for consistency, I had it so each letter is its own element, with a set width and height. Now, I can simply import the lib into my game source file, use the APIs, and get a functional pseudo Quine game, of course, with a placeholder text on which to render the game. And here comes the final piece of the puzzle, the tool that compiles everything together and spits out the sought-after result, a bona fide Quine video game. This tool needs to do a couple of things. First, take the source code and create a reference to it that is to be rendered as the background. This is done with a bit of editing the source file by adding an import for a function from the lib that allows to set the background text, as well as assigning the entirety of the program to a function whose textual representation can be obtained via string interpolation. At the end, the assigned function is called as the program is now self-executing. Second, bundle all the source files into a single file. This is done using Rollup, a highly customizable JavaScript module bundler, which navigates the imports or dependency tree and properly handles their inclusion into a singular file. As a note, this is not the default behavior, as it would normally try to separate the resulting file into chunks to be more easily served by the server, but that's not what I'm looking for here. And lastly, minify the resulting bundle as to ensure the code is in its most condensed form. I achieved this using the Terser plugin for Rollup. Its role is to shrink variable names, remove white spaces and comments, and drop any unused code. Had to dig a bit and see what config options I had to use to get what I wanted, but it was mostly straightforward. Except for a tiny thing. See, this Terser is a smart little thing, but like all smart things, it's also very worrisome. Of course, it doesn't state it outright, you really have to understand why it does what it does to get what you really want out of it. But the thing is, it won't shrink any names that might refer to reserved words, in order to prevent any wrongful modifications of official APIs. So, when writing your code, it's better to use explicit names, even if they are longer, instead of generic stuff like state or window, even for property names. Also, keywords cannot be shrunk, for obvious reasons, so in order to reduce the final size as much as possible, I also tried to restructure the code to make use of as few as possible, or if I had to, I would choose the keyword whose token was the shortest. But aside from those small caveats, the final product is ready to be revealed. And honestly, I did not really expect for it to turn out this well. It's running really well, you can actually kinda understand what each tile is or does. The game loop seems to be working okay, just like the scoring and leveling mechanics. And all is running directly on its own source code. Quite the trippy feat. Now I can just kick back and wait for someone to recreate Elden Ring with this, and if that someone is you, well, Godspeed, Space Cowboy.